המשיח יהושע, המשיח יהושע.
Shalom, shalom, brothers and sisters, and once again, you're now under the sounds of your voice, of the voice of your brother, Taza Dark. Today's topic, I entitle, Are You Sui Juris, a Sovereign, a National, or a 14th Amendment Citizen? You know, and before I begin, you know, I'd like to say, you know, I appreciate those that actually have actually made donations for my time and energy. And to those of you that just like to take and take and take and never give back, you destroy the universe. And I am grateful for your being in your degenerate condition. Probably because of the courses of your thought. Your actions to always take and never give back perhaps has rendered you to your present condition. Now, with that being said, are you sui juris, a sovereign, national, or a 14th Amendment citizen? Now, the uncommon sense of I, Taza Dark, a grieved man that is actually essentially fighting for his rights back from a de facto, is my stance. Knowledge is power, and right knowledge is essential. So in the land of the sane are rendered as insane. And I know many of you that's caught up within this matrix has actually rendered me insane by watching my videos. And I can determine that based on your responses. And, you know, we've actually been taught that we are supposed to spend most of our lives being a biatch to a system that pimps you like a bunch of whores because you consent. Excuse my language, but I'm just being straightforward. Now, it's a game of chess. So my question to you is, will your next move be a biatch move? Or will you become one of the rulers of those in their public servant capacity? That's the question. That is the $500,000 question. Now, I, Taza Dark, am just a grieved man. But I do understand that I am only subservient to my Creator. And I really believe that in my mind. And until you believe that, you will never comprehend this day. See, the Most High gave man dominion over all except for himself. So why do you feel that the judge have authority over you? Why are you brothers and sisters contacting me in fear of the judge acting as if the judge has authority over you? Book of Genesis 1 and 26 reads as thus. And God said, let us make man in our image after our likeness and let them, man, and do understand that men is not the plural of man. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowl of the air and over the cattle and over all the earth. That includes judges, that includes lawyers, that includes policemen, and so on and so forth. They are all in a public servant capacity. While they are in their public servant capacity. Understand this. You policemen are supposed to serve and protect. And a system is going to be put in place that if you do not serve and protect properly, then your service is no longer needed. So man is the supreme authority. And authority is sovereign. So therefore, man is king. So why are they asking me anything? I, the king, should be the one that's asking. Because if you're as king, then you're as the king. Do you understand? So agents for the state of New York took a friend's son, whom actually asked me for direction, and I told him, hey, I do not offer legal advice. I do not give legal advice, but I could actually educate you on how I would respond that, and perhaps you could actually use my response as guidance and direction. And he, being a grieved man like I myself, concurred. So he asked for direction on getting his son back. So the agents of the state, CPS, took his son without cause or due process of law. So, you know, the brother that contacted me had his son stolen approximately 6 years ago prior to contacting me and wanted to get his son back. Now, he entered a contract with the agents of the state to give up his child. And if you listen to my videos in the past, child is a fiction owned by the state by way of the mother informing on her son or daughter that, hey, they had new property for the state. And signing that live record of birth, thereby signing her son or daughter over to the state, making it a child. Do you understand? So men and women, understand this. Men and women have sons and daughters. Men and women don't have children and kids. A kid is a goat. A child is a fiction. And I am not a parent. I am a father. I fat my son, a daughter, with knowledge. So you must understand that words are vitally important, people, when you are speaking. So now, contract for this brother, a contract was supposedly in the case file in front of the black robe that many of you refer to as a judge. I refer to as a magistrate or the black robe, but it could not be found anywhere. Now I thought, that's weird. And the state said that the brother had gotten a copy when he signed. So we do not have to provide one. So the state, they didn't lie. There is a contract in the case file, but it belonged to someone else, and it did not belong to my friend whom I was actually providing direction and education and entertaining. Now, I directed my friend based upon the course of my actions as to what I would do. You know, so I suggested that, hey, I conditionally accept your offer for $2 million, but that does not negate the fact that there is still an outstanding balance between Jones, my friend, and New York. Now, to all of you that's listening, now that understand this and overstand this. If you say, you know, you need a certain amount of money to make you whole and complete, for example, $2 million, if you said $2 million would make you complete, and the state comes back with a counter offer for you and says, well, we're going to give you $1 million, and you accept it, well, then your $2 million claim was a false claim, and then every part of your claim gets thrown away and dismissed. Do you understand? Do you understand? So people, you must stand your ground on the claim's fact and values. The claim is as you claim, point blank. If you want to accept a lower counter offer, then your claim, then you may agree to accept the partial payment of $1 million. But, there is a very important but there. But, you will forgive the balance out of the kindness of your heart. So you need to keep that in mind. Keep in mind, if you do this, the record must show. It must show. For the record and on the record and let the record show that forgiveness as part of the debt, the $1 million. But the full claim still remains the same. Do you understand? So they may lower the offer with, you know, the goal of actually getting you to change your mind. Don't fall for the okey-doke. Do not fall for the okey-doke. Once they make the offer, you may counter offer with your kind response. Well, I conditionally accept your offer. And out of the kindness of my heart, I'm going to accept $1 million and forgive you of the other $1 million out of the kindness of my heart. I accept your offer to pay $1 million by February 27, 2015 for partial payment of your debt. And because I, Tazi Doc, am a merciful man, I will forgive you the balance due of your debt of $2 million. Do you follow me? Do you follow me, folks? It's essential that you state that. Now, keep in mind that the court is you, the jury, and the defendant. It is the order of the court means that you and the jury and defendant are the court. We're the court. Tazi Doc, the jury, and defendant. That's the court, not the black robe, not the clerks of the court, not the bailiff. Because why, Tazi Doc? You don't see the word A, the, this court. It's just court. So the court is the record of agreement. The agreement is the judgment or authority. Do you follow me? You still with me? So it is the order of the court that the state of New York court is to be known to the world as void and inattunable and all of its subsequent orders or to have no force of operation. So that's how simple an order has to be. Just basically saying, I, Tazi Doc, man, want the world to look at this case as a false case and that every subsequent order that came from this case is to be noticed as void or known as. So you don't want to use the word deem. You don't want to use the word deem because deem, again, is a legalese word. And if you've been listening to my recent videos, I suggest that you avoid using legalese. So many of you, you contact me, you're using your fancy big legalese words. And when I suggest that you change it to something more simplistic, you go into bitch mode. You get frantic. You become scared. You put on pink panties. Keep it simple, brothers and sisters. Keep it very simple. So, you know, the documents that I write does not have legal lease in them. So when they try to come after me with their legal lease, I tell them, hey, I'm an idiot. Well, Mr. Tazi Doc, are you pro se? No, I am not pro se. I do not know what that means. Where can I find that in common parlance? Common term, please. I am not pro se. I am just a man. My capacity is man. And I am the authority under my creator. I just gave you Genesis 1:26. I didn't make it up. I'm just quoting what the book says. Do they not have you swear on the Bible or affirm? I'm just quoting what the book says. I am. And if you try to diminish my standing, I can accept that. I am just an aggrieved man. And aggrieved essentially means somebody who has lost his rights and wants his rights back or to be justly compensated for you attempting to deprive me or taking or depriving me of my rights. So, if you watch my older videos, brothers and sisters, I used to use a lot of UCC codes. Not anymore. Because why? As I became wiser and grow in wisdom, I realized that the number one thing that I did wrong is use their codes. Use their UCC codes. Use their statutes. Quote their statutes. This is why, in the beginning, I would get caught up with that 12b6. Well, what do you mean, Tazadok 12b6? Well, FRCP rule 12b6, failure to state a claim. You must state your claim. You must make your claim, and then you take it to your court. See, it took me years to understand what a 12b6 was, brothers and sisters. But then, I realized it. It came to me. See, they are saying that they agree with every single fact that I was saying. It's just that I was not providing them the law in which the court can invoke jurisdiction, the power over the people, over the other party. I was using Title 42, 1983, claiming civil rights. See, the problem was I, Tazadok, man, was asking for something that Title 42, Section 1983, did not allow me to ask for in the form of relief. Do you understand? Do you overstand? Do you at least understand? See, I'm warning you people, if you use their codes and you do not use them exactly as they are written, you know, they're going to say, there's nowhere in Title 42, 1983, civil rights statutes that says anything about being able to force the state to turn over the case files. So, in 2009, I was writing, you know, my documents, and they challenged all the codes that I was using. So, unless you wrote the codes, then you're not qualified to interpret them, brother. The judge may interpret them differently. The attorney may interpret them differently. Do you understand? So now when I am before the black roll, I just go in as a man. Or if I'm before the jury, I just go in as a man. And I say, Judge, sir, you have an oath of office. You have a duty to function to that oath of office. You move under Article 6, Clause 3. You took an oath to uphold the Constitution of the Republic. And you are bound by that oath, and I'm going to hold you to that oath. It's really that simple, folks. See, my job as a man is to create orders, and your job, judge, is to just see that my orders get stamped and get delivered to the other side. You're just a referee. You're just an official. A judge cannot practice law and sit a bench. And the other side has, as far as I'm concerned, 21 days to either accept or appeal the order. Then we come back and have a common law court, a record trial, where the jury will be the judge and determine the facts and determine the law. I don't need you, judge, in any capacity whatsoever to judge anything. Do you understand? Do you understand? So, the summons that I have a tendency to always modify their summons. And folks, please be very careful to be federal district court and not a United States district court. It is a good idea to use their forms, yet you cut, copy, and paste because it's actually styled like they do it. What are they going to complain about? And again, this is not legal advice. By the way, did I say that? This is not legal advice. I do not offer legal advice. If you need legal advice, I tell you what. Seek yourself a competent counsel, and then please be advised. So, excuse me. It's like when you pay a bill to the electric company. They just run your bill through the machine. Nobody actually opens the bill and read it. So, you know, for instance, it says summons in a civil action to the defendant. And then it just says a lawsuit actually has been filed against you within 21 days after the service of the summons, not counting the day that you received it. So 60 days if you are a United States agency or an officer or an employee of the United States described in Civil Rule Procedure 12. Or 90 days in a Social Security action, you must actually serve on the plaintiff to answer to the attached complaint or motion under 12 of the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure. So the answer or the motion must actually be served on the plaintiff or the plaintiff's attorney whose names and address are here. That's what I annotate on. Very similar to theirs, but much more simpler. You see, mine just says, after 21 days, at the service of the summons, on you, not counting the day that you received it, you must serve on the prosecutor a verifiable answer to this suit or make your wish known to the tribunal you want court to try the matter on the 22nd day. That's why you do it, because you want the court to try the matter on the 22nd day. And only a man can give a verified answer. A certified answer comes from an attorney. But only a man can give a verified, not verifiable, a verified answer. You see, I comprehend that when I, man, look at a judge, I'm looking at a magistrate, a public servant, who is actually glorified by those of you that fear him. So, you know, at the bottom of my summons, I said, usually, if you fail to present a verified answer, not verifiable, a verified answer, a judgment by default will be entered into the record against you, and the immediate execution of the orders will commence upon the 22nd day. And you know, keep it very simple, folks. And to those of you that don't know what a default judgment is, it just means that the man did not show up. They can hold the order in abeyance for 7 years. Now, is there a verdict not certified criminal complaint before this court? Is there a verified, not certified, criminal complaint before this court? Now, I don't care, brothers and sisters, because, you know, one brother called me about a gun charge. He had a gun charge. The brother was very panicky. And he knew the right things to say, but fear overcame him. So I want, brother, I know you're probably watching this video and listening to it. Understand this, all of you under the sounds of my voice, for informational and educational and entertainment purposes, I don't care if it's crystal meth trafficking, and I do not encourage that by any way. In fact, I'm against it. I don't care if you've been actually trafficking AK-47s, and I don't encourage that by any means. I don't care if it's anything. My response is, who is the injured party? Who is the injured party? Where is the corpus delicti? I was trying to get a friend to see that. Brother, you know who you are. just a day and a half ago. Again, he called me, he was scared to death. He was charged with three counts of possession of a weapon. And I asked him, was he a man? And he said, yes, of course I'm a man. What are you talking about? I said, well, does not a man have a right to defend himself? Does he need permission from a public servant to defend himself? Does he need a permit? To permit means to allow. So are you telling me you're not allowed to defend yourself unless you have a permit? Is that what you're saying? It's just a question. Furthermore, I asked him, where is the corpus delicti? Where is the corpus delicti? And there wasn't one. So I told him that they would go crazy and start seeing things like, no, I want you to plead guilty. How do you plead? No, not guilty. No contest. How do you plead? And then, if you have actually set yourself up as a defendant, you've given them jurisdiction over you, so the judge may enter plea for you. But how do you plead, Tazi Doc? Well, I've already answered you, sir. Sir, I've already answered you. And I don't open my mouth again. Because what you say in court will override what you have on the record. Everything that you submitted to the court before you open your mouth gets overthrown by what you're saying in court. Now you're starting an entire brand new contract with the judge. Do you understand? So it's really that simple, folks. You just say, do you have what I wrote in front of you? Judge, do you not have what I wrote in front of you? Did you not get the record? Oh, yes, I do. Well, that's all I have to say to this court at this time. If you do not want to hold me, or if you want to hold me, or enter a plea for me, then I'm going to charge you $50,000 a day, Judge, for every day you hold me in here until the injured party appears. And if he doesn't appear, the clock is ticking. $5 for every second that you interfere with my rights. What is your wish, Judge? It's that simple. It's that simple. What do you mean, Tata Doc? Well, wish is a powerful word. What do you mean, what is your wish, Tata Doc? The judge is not a genie. Are you a genie, Tata Doc? No. Wish is a powerful word, Doc. So if the mother and the father wish to have the son to be returned to them, then the son must be placed back in their custody. Because the son was not placed in someone else's custody because the son was not under a crime, not under a conviction. So if the mother and the father wish to have their son returned to them based upon a contract with the state, the son is to be returned to the father and mother immediately. That's law. That's law. You have to use words correctly, folks. You have to say, I wish to have my son returned to me immediately. Point blank. I want my son returned. It's not, I wish to have my son returned. Words are vitally important. Only a man can make a wish. Only a man can make a wish. So until you make a wish in court, and you know, I was actually observing a few cases on YouTube, and the judge said, do you wish to be sentenced to one of the defendants? Or do you want to come back and sit in court again? You see, one thing I discovered is that these black robes actually use the word wish a lot, because only a man can make a wish, and once you make a wish, hey, it's going to be granted. I mean, I don't mean to sound like no genie, That's what the judge is there to do, to grant you your wish. You ordered a judge around. Genesis 1 and 26. But not if you're going to be a little wussy. So most of you, you don't get your children back because you don't know how to respond. You believe that you have to get an expensive lawyer and attend parenting classes. Then you contact me after you're already in dishonor and you created this big mess. Then you want me to expend my time and my energy for nothing. You won't even make a donation. You wait until you go in dishonor to even make a donation. Shame on you. So, you see, if the child was taken into custody, and this is under the Social Security Act 672, subsection F, under the Title 42, and it is actually under the Medicaid Act of 472, subsection F, it states exactly what I just said, that if the child is actually taken into the state's custody, the parents must approach the state. The state is not allowed to approach the parents with a contract. So, for years, many of you have been defending yourselves against criminal charges that really didn't exist. That really didn't exist. Do you understand? Do you understand? So, folks, I'm telling you, CPS needs a verified criminal complaint before the sheriff's department or the county prosecutor can talk to you. And once you do that, I'm going to move because that's my property. Who in this hell is going to tell me or touch my property without my consent? Go ahead, I dare you. I dare you. I dare you. Wait just a minute, Tazada. What do you mean your property? What does property mean? Are you calling your son your property? Absolutely. You see, wherever I claim, whatever I claim is proper to my portion, which I believe I have the exclusive right to enjoyment thereof and to enjoy, is my property. My wife is my property, and I'm hers. We have an agreement that I am proper to her person. She's got exclusive rights to enjoy me, and nobody else can make that claim. Do you understand? Do you understand? So does anyone in this room claim to have a claim to my property? Is there anyone in the court that claims to have a claim to my property? To my son? You see, people, you're losing your sons and daughters because everybody you talk to believe that the state has a right to touch your sons and daughters that you refer to as children. And, you know, attorneys generally say state has no right to take your children unless you abuse them or something of that nature and so on and so forth. You see, by me, I just want a common law court of record trial. It's that simple. The common law is the law of the land. There is no higher law. Google the word land. Land means people, and the common law court is the land of the people. It's the land of the people. So how many of you have ever seen the movie Excalibur? Remember King Arthur? The king and the land is one. It's one. It's one. That's true. The king and the land is one. The king and the people are on equal footing and equal sovereigns. King is the ruler and sovereign. I, man, am king and will only be ruled by my creator. Yahweh Baha Shem, Yahweh Shem. Now, Can you show me where a court of record is outlawed? Show me. Show me the law. And the last thing that I want to touch on in this video is that it's not plaintiff versus defendant. It is prosecutor versus the wrongdoer. I am the prosecutor because, hey, if you come against me, I'm going to put a claim against you. So I'm going to counterclaim and put a claim against you and move it to my court. I am the one that's moving the claim. I'm moving the claim. I don't do any of that this judicial notice. Get rid of all of these adjectives and so on and so forth. Just make it one word. Notice. I send them a notice. Notice. I don't need to say judicial notice. Just notice. Are you a free man on the land, Tazadot? No. I'm just a man. All I know is I am a man. All I know is when I read the scriptures in Genesis 1 and 26, the Most High gave me man dominion over everything. That means you judge. That means you lawyer. That means you bailiff. All I know is I'm the man. So, you're not going to diminish my capacity as a man. In this country, man created the government. People, you need to wake up and understand that. The government answers to man. Man answers to the Most High, his creator. Until you grasp that concept, you're truly never going to know how to truly be a man. And I don't mean to insult your intelligence. 1 Corinthians 11 verse 3 says, "But I will have you know that the head of every man is Christ. And the head of every woman, is the man, and the head of Christ is God." Well, are you a citizen? See, I'm not even going down that path. What does being a citizen has to do with you kidnapping my son? Did you or did you not kidnap my son? Well, are you a citizen? No, 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 no. I am the prosecutor here. I am the one that's moving this court. I am the one that's asking the questions. Because I'm the king. Do you have a claim against me? No. Well, then you are moving under my rules. If you don't have a claim against me, do you have a verified claim? The defendant does not have to show up, but the plaintiff must show up. The defendant's attorney can show up, but the plaintiff must be standing there next to the attorney. Do you understand? The plaintiff must appear. Whenever you want your brother, or if you file a false claim, we're going to demand you, and we might triple or quadruple that. So if you injure somebody, you better compensate them quickly, brothers and sisters, to offer, you know, to wash their car, to walk their dogs, and so on and so forth. But when a government or a county for a speeding ticket or something, no, no, no. I am filing a counterclaim against you. Why? Because you're not going to bring an injured party before the court. And I already know that. So, if the plaintiff shows up, I'm going to compensate him right away. But he's got to put his hand on the Bible and verify that I injured him. Do you understand? For the speeding ticket garbage. Well, the state says it. They better put their hand. Well, Tazadok versus the state. Okay, well, the state says it. Well, then the state better put its hand on the Bible and verify it. Visa? Tazadok, you owe us $3,000 in credit card debt. Well, put your hand on the Bible and verify that. Under oath of affirmation. Do you understand? Do you understand? So you put the government back where they belong, just as a referee before a common law court record. If they do not return your child, you're going to charge them with X amount of dollars for every second that they're holding them in naked possession of your child unlawfully. And you know what I mean, sons and daughters, but speaking in common parlance or speaking in a language you could understand, I'll say child. So, there you have it, folks. And I started off asking a question, you know, are you serving jurors? But I didn't even really touch on that. So real quick, I'll touch on that before I close this thing. I really don't want to make this video too long, but are you serving jurors? Now, the first thing, we have evidence, two legal definitions of serving jurors. Serving jurors, one who has all the rights to which a free man is entitled, one who is not under the power of authority, as a slave minor and the like. To make a valid contract, a person must, in general, be suri juris. Everyone of full age is presumed to be suri juris. That's according to Bouvier's Law Dictionary, 1856. The second definition that I have is of full capacity in his own right, capable of entering into a contract. That's a Ballantyne Law Dictionary, third edition. Now, I want you to please note, both definitions have the element of contract. Contract. Now, please note that the first definition that I provided states one who is not under the power of another, a slave, a minor, and the like. Now, consequently, all such persons of such nature are not considered to be of a suri juris status. Now, let us consider some elements to see if you are of the like. See, if you are not of the like and are not under the power of another, then I want you to answer the following question. It's just questions. Are you a citizen of the United States? And are you willing to be one? Do you have and willingly utilize a social security number? And do you plan to take benefits from the Social Security program? Just questions. Just two questions. If you answer yes to either one of these questions that I just asked you, you are truly not suri juris. So stop saying that you are. Why? Why you ask? Because in essence, you as an adult, under the guardianship of the federal government, you're the federal baby, the government's your daddy, Obama's your daddy, the United States. You know, to further explain this, when you turn 18, the legal age of majority, when you turn 18 years of age, you had the choice to be a dependent of the federal government or to become fully suri juris. As you voluntarily elected to be the United States citizen, thus having to take a social security number based on a positive law of the federal nation, you went from being a child or a son or daughter of your mother and father to being a child of the government. Now Obama's your daddy. So, unbeknownst known to you, this was the first hidden contract, the first adhesion contract when you reach your age of majority. It is called acquiescence by silence. I'll give you a couple more definitions and I'm going to close this thing out. And I trust that you've learned something here. Subscribe to the channel. Share this video with as many people as possible because education is power. And if you like the video, take a second and like the video. Thumbs up. And oh, big up to all my haters. Nevertheless, taken from the American Heritage Dictionary, dependent is contingent on another. It's a subordinate, relying on or requiring the aid of another for support. Dependent children, for example. Hanging down, dependent, also dependent, one who relies on another, especially for financial support. What's a guardian? One that guards, watches over, or protects. Law, one who is legally responsible for the care and management of the person or property of an incompetent or minor. That's a guardian. Vassal, a person who held land from a federal lord and received protection in return from homage and allegiance. A bondman, a slave, a subordinate, a dependent. So, without a doubt, all of the definitions that I just provided fit perfectly and are applicable. So, the situation is this is actually imposed on you. Section 1 of the 14th Amendment of the Federal Constitution fundamentally naturalizes you at birth and takes you out of your native state of birth. You are then a federal national rather than a lawful national of your state, which is in truth your country. So due to this inflicted situation, you are more than of the like. You're more than of the like. Not only are you considered a minor, which has nothing to do with numbers, it is a status. You are specifically a slave or in servitude if you vote. You may see fiction of law and silent judicial notice for the particulars of what I'm actually just citing. So in other words, you do not have to be duly convicted to be in servitude. You are silently condemned for being a United States citizen by way of the 14th Amendment. So under the doctrine of tactic and positive law, you have volunteered and contracted to be a United States citizen and have lost your rights, your God-given rights, your inalienable rights that was inherited from birth to the state. The citizens cannot complain because he has voluntarily submitted himself to such a form of government and must pay the penalties. And with that, brothers and sisters, I'm going to bring this to a close. And again, you have been under the sounds of Tyler Doc. Again, subscribe to the channel, share the video, teach as many people as you can. And if you learn something from this, hey, donate for my time and energy and knowledge. And then you teach others. I'm going to say shalom. Shalom.